let's see what happens. A metal construct stands before you, silent and still. Its armor is pitted and ancient, spiked with metal thorns. Instead of arms, the construct has long killing blades, sharpened to a gleaming edge. At first you aren't sure if the thing is still alive, but as you step closer, you can hear faint hisses and whirs from inside its armor. Okay, so we do get little notifications about the codex. There was another one. You sense a mind inside the machine. Is a mind so alien that, although you can hear it, you cannot understand its thoughts. Who are you? The construct stirs, and a voice emanates from somewhere in its depths. It has a hollow, empty sound, as if it speaks from a vast cavern underground. I am a soldier, a predator. My names are as numerous as the wars in which I have fought. But those wars are finished now, and I have left my names behind. Surely you remember some of your names. Some? I remember all my names. Exonarch Sirius 14. Gensero Mark 10. When I was a bodyguard to Vostilla Lo, he called me his barber of flesh and made of me a boogeyman, feared and hated in every nation he conquered. The construct says nothing after that, but the hisses and whirs inside its armor make a great deal of noise for what seems a long time. Okay, from the way that other guy was talking, I thought it would just automatically attack me. Who created you? I do not know, nor have I ever known. They culled all record of themselves from our minds. I only remember those for whom I fought, and there have been many such masters over many long millennia of service. For a time, I believe, my siblings and I slept. I do not know for how long. Then we were awakened by new masters, the Tabat. We fought for them until they were no more. You fought for the Tabat? What do you remember about them? Much. They ruled this land as warlords before the building of Sega's cliffs. They were slaves to an edifice known as the Underspine, yet they were its masters as well. I do not know where they came from or who they were before they rose to power, for those things happened before they awakened me. I remember this too. They held single combat as the highest virtue, revealing the quality of one's soul. They believed that we had powerful souls, my siblings and I, for none of them could defeat us alone. They fought on two-legged beasts, brandishing weapons of another age, unearthed from great hordes beneath the ground. That is also where they found me, and my siblings. They awakened us, spoke the proper words, so we killed on their command. What happened to the Tabat? The construct's blade arms twitched convulsively. A vast explosion buried the Underspine, and their city, and most of my siblings as well. The remaining Tabat were hunted and slain by those that they had ruled and enslaved, and I was left alone, save for a few of my kind. I will answer if I can. What are you doing here? Waiting. The word is hollow and cold. For those who are strong and feared, for the predators who walk the bloom, they come here, at times, to challenge me. If I prove myself to be a predator above all others, I believe that the bloom tongues will catch my scent. The clicks and hisses from inside the construct's armor suddenly go quiet. I wish to be devoured by the bloom. Have you not seen those who have passed through the gullet of the bloom? Every trace of who they were has been stripped from them. They are freed from the trappings of memory and self, reborn. I haven't met anyone who's been eaten by the bloom, period. Why do you crave rebirth? How many years have you lived? Only a few, judging by the firmness of your flesh. In that time, what horrors have you witnessed or perpetrated? Do they slip into your mind in unguarded moments, Perhaps they do. Whatever horrors you have seen, multiply them by 1,000, 100,000, across a vast, grinding millennium of wars. Now imagine that you cannot forget, cannot even distract yourself with other memories. Do you know what I remember? Only those things that would make me a better killer. Every severed limb, every gout of heart's blood, every cruel execution before a cheering crowd. All else is lost, for that is how my creators fashioned my brain. That is why I crave rebirth and forgetfulness. To escape the horrors that I have witnessed and wrought, to become something more than my creators made me. Killing powerful predators makes you more appetizing to the bloom? So I believe. The construct is silent for a moment, as if considering. I have observed the patterns of its hunger over many feeding cycles. Always it is those who prey on others who draw the attention of the bloom tongues. The greater the predator, the more powerful their victims, the more the bloom desires them. The construct's voice becomes less hollow, higher pitched, and more grating. And I have killed many, so many. I have torn men and beasts asunder, left their bones and entrails to putrefy as an offering to the bloom tongues, and still, it will not devour me. Why does it wait? I cannot know. You claim to be troubled by the violent things you've seen and done, but you're a killing machine. Why should those things bother you? A long moment passes before the construct speaks. I have pondered that question for all the years since I awoke in your world, and also during the long aeons of my sleep. For centuries I felt no such revulsion at the memories of my past, but over time the horror grew in my mind, and in the minds of all my brethren. The construct pauses again, as if considering its next words. I have come to believe that our creators intended this. Perhaps they understood the terrors we could visit upon the world, and this was their way of ensuring that we would not endure forever. If our foes did not destroy us, then we would be driven to destroy ourselves. I haven't met anyone who's been eaten by the bloom and lived. Walk the innards of this city monster for long enough, and you will meet them. A series of lights flash in quick succession on one side of the construct's faceplate. Even now I can taste the transdimensional footfalls of one such man. You may find him in the vast interior space beyond the arterial opening there. The construct gestures with one bladed arm to its right. Once he possessed a name that was well known in this place before it was stolen by another. Now he walks alone, forgotten, and without fear. I want you to kill me. What are all these bones and armor on the ground? Detritus of beasts and men, it is all that remains of those who sought to best me. What do you know about Dracogen? He is a predator of sorts, but subtler than most. I have observed him as one hunter watches another from afar, but I cannot fathom what he truly wants. What he seems is not all that he is. Do you mean that Dracogen isn't all that he seems? No. The hollow voice is sharper and somehow more dangerous. The words I spoke were exactly what I meant. Why don't you challenge Dracogen to combat? What do you say about this? What he seems is not all that he is. Isn't all that he's... What's the difference? Yeah, why don't you challenge him to combat? The construct's head turns in Dracogen's direction. Even though the great-skinned man is not actually visible from here, obscured as he is by the crashed katana, you sense that the construct's eyes can see him plainly. For a long moment you hear a series of whirring and humming sounds from inside the construct's head, as if the creature is considering your words. Then, at long last, it turns its head back to you. No, even I would not dare. The words are firm, with a note of finality. I'm not gonna do combat or killing yet. A series of lights flash beneath the construct's faceplate, but it makes no audible reply. Okay. Yeah, at some point, before I leave here, I'll come back and see. I'll, of course, save the game first. The construct there, I call it waits for prey, but it answers to no names at all. We can talk to this, apparently. Anine? Oh, I gotta read the codex about waits for prey, too. A large and agitated beast looms over you. It is an inine, a beast of burden. These creatures are normally docile, but this one bares its teeth and snaps at you as you draw near. It rakes the air with its stubby claws. Examine it. A codex for inine. Staying just out of biting range, you can see blood around the inine's mouth. It looks like it has been bleeding or possibly feeding on something. Let me check my codex before I forget. So obviously this is going to be under... Well, this character's waits for prey, right? Creatures. Oh, it's under creature as well. Okay, the inine. These bipedal herd animals are common pack and riding animals. Their small forelimbs and tiny claws keep them from being much of a threat to their handlers, and their generally docile natures make them ideal for long journeys, even across worlds and through the maws of the bloom. Waits for prey. Waits for prey is an ancient construct created for battle. It is humanoid, but its entire body is lined with thorns and spikes, and its arms are long killing blades. Originally built by some vanished civilization from a prior world, it is now one of the last of its kind. Waits for prey has been standing in the Meravira's courtyard for decades, accepting challenges from powerful people and creatures, and it has never been defeated. Hmm. Do we dare screw with this thing? This wagon is laden with basic supplies from outside the bloom. Alright. I guess we're gonna touch it now. A large and agitated inine blooms over you. Or looms over you, so I got bloom on the mind. It bares its teeth and snaps at you. Touch it. As you approach, it snaps its head forward, snarling. Try to pull your hand back. I'm almost out of speed. Is all this quick finger stuff going on in here. I'm gonna fail. Or success. Stat pool spent on effort restored. Critical success? Really? You jerk your hand back and the anine's jaws snap shut scant inches from your fingertips. Okay. I don't have an option to touch it again, so I'll leave it alone. Skaydi, what's up? I can also interact with this thing. A pale, heavy-set merchant woman stands by an agitated inine. Her eyes seem to have trouble focusing on you, and when they do, she drops them, her hands nervously adjusting the scarf around her neck. She thinks, need help, can't think, I must... Okay, we got another, construct here. I'm Skaydi. You here to trade? Why are you wearing that heavy scarf? That's the most important thing. Her eyes meet yours, and for a moment you almost think there's a pleading quality to them. Then they blaze with fury. That's none of your business. Leave it be or just leave. Perception reveals as she speaks, she fiddles with her scarf again, and you notice splotches of blood on it. It bit her, didn't it? She thinks, scarf? I forgot. I put it on to hide... Nothing. It hides nothing. Are you possessed by little demons, too? Or can this thing read her mind? I'm gonna mess with this after. Can you tell me about the bloom? The bloom? For a moment, she appears confused, as if she doesn't remember where she is. No. No. What's to tell? Are you sure you have nothing to tell me about the bloom? She pauses, brow furrowing. I think so. There might be something wrong with your anine. It has blood around its mouth. She pulls her scarf up. I don't need strangers telling me how to take care of my beast, thank you. Do you want something? You want to buy something or not? She thinks, leave her alone. It's not the beast's fault. Your anine tried to bite me. She sneers. What were you trying to do? Pet it? Just leave it be. Let me see what you have for sale. What does she have? Right? We got spray flesh. Verd. This looks better. Basic stuff, huh? Star's Kiss? We don't have something like that, do we? No, he has an outworn buckler. She has a regular shield. Star's Kiss. Plus 10% evasion. Well, that's a regular shield. Nope, I'm looking at the wrong thing. Where was it? Oh, wait. I have Star's Kiss, duh. So I have a Panacea. Cypher. It's expensive. Heals 30 points of health on all allies in range of target point. A thin cooling gel mortars the stacked ceramic discs that make up this device. Turning the topmost disc triggers a glowing field that cures even the most grievous injuries. If we had more, I'd definitely get it. But we don't, so... Still Mirror. It's another cipher. Target is allies in medium area around caster. Another thing that's too expensive right now. Heals 20 points of health and removes all negative fettles from allies in range. Except for flanked and lasting damage. This brass hoop's surface has incredibly intricate engravings. If twisted, the hoop falls apart, and all emotion is swept from the area. My mystical lore tells me that still mirrors had a proud history. Once they were used to maintain order, but the few that remain today are carefully guarded and used for darker purposes. Interesting. This is a clockwork strut. A bonded artifact. Plus 30% oh my god, it's so expensive, 815. Plus 30% evasion, and plus 1 training and quick finger skill. Negative though, minus 2 armor. And minus 1 training in endurance. This array of oiled clockwork slats bonds with the user's limbs, accelerating their movements, but leaving their overstressed muscles far more prone to injury. And finally, she has a Talisman of the Gentle Hierophant, which is another bonded artifact. Max effort plus 1 on all non-combat tasks. Negative effects max effort minus 1 on attacks. Glyphs of unknown planets circling a binary star are inscribed on this talisman. This disc melds with the user's chest, filling them with determination and sickening thoughts of violence. Hey, but you could be filled with determination! Get that reference. Okay, so we have 3 spray flash. Spray flash. How much are they? 40. I'll get 2. Do I have stuff that I don't need? I don't want to get rid of the liquid death. Yeah, unfortunately we don't have really much to sell. Or actually anything to sell. Alright, let's mess with her some more. Skaydi eyes you suspiciously, tugging at her heavy scarf. What do you want this time? Persuasion. I'm out of quick, so... Try to see under her scarf. You have a little something on your scarf, right there under your chin. 85%. I do? Where? The woman pulls the scarf from her neck to look at it, revealing jagged, still bleeding teeth marks on her throat. She sees you staring at them and realizes she's been duped. Dirty trickster! She snarls as she pulls the scarf tight again. Go try your games on someone else. She thinks, please, just leave us alone. Skaydi glances at her anine, eyes wide like a child, with a guilty conscience. You recall the anine's bloody mouth and the odd behavior, and it occurs to you that its teeth match the size and pattern of the bite marks on her neck. Elementary, my dear Watson. My natural lore tells me that anine are herbivores, and as far as you know, they can't digest meat or blood. Curious. She wrenches her eyes away from her anine, closes them tightly, and begins to shake her head rapidly back and forth, muttering incoherently. Her whispers sound more like buzzing and hissing than words. I can help. Just tell me what's happening to you. Persuasion. 70? Yes. Success! My anine, it feeds on me. Suckles the blood from my neck. For some reason I can't... No. I don't want to make it stop. She shakes her head, trying to clear it. But that's a lie. I do want it to stop. Okay, which is it? Her voice quavers in terror. I think the bloom did this. To my anine and to me. Tied us together somehow. It's in our heads. I can hear it whispering to me. Persuasion. Persuasion. Fight the bloom, Skaydi. Concentrate on the whispers and drown them out. Push them from your mind. 70. Success. You can see the woman struggle. Her whole body shakes. You faintly hear a whispering cacophony of sound, chittering and buzzing, lashing out in rage as it fights back. Then it falls silent. The merchant's eyes soften and focus. She shakes her head as if clearing it. I did it. The voices are gone. The anine also shakes its head, snorts, and settles back on its haunches. The merchant turns to you with clearer eyes. Thank you. I don't know what was wrong with me. The bloom got in my head and changed my anine, too. But I think she's back to her old self now. She hesitates, then nods. You can come back anytime you like. I'll give you a discount. It's the least I can do. Great, we already bought everything we need. At least until we have more money. Can you retroactively give me a discount now? Skaydi smiles warmly as you approach. Hello again, my friend. What can I do for you? How is your anine now? We haven't even moved. Shaken, but better. And now that I know this can happen, I won't risk it happening again. We're getting out of the bloom as soon as I sell my stock, and we're not coming back. How did the bloom get into your head? I don't know. The bloom does strange things to you if you stay here long enough. My anine and I drank water from that well. That might have something to do with it, or maybe not, but I'm not letting her drink it again, that's for sure. She thinks, pure as the cliffs, he said. Damn that Chrysler. Can you tell me about the bloom? Yeah, now she can say stuff about it. I travel through here a lot, but maybe not after this. Too dangerous, no matter what the Memavira's guards say about her keeping it safe. She shrugs. Good chance for profit, though. Bloom folk need outside goods, and you can find unique things here. Things from other places. Still, once bitten, twice shy, if you know what I mean. I'm gone as soon as I sell the last of my stock. Yeah, see what you did there. I can't tell you more than I already have. Stay on the Memovira's good side, keep your head down, and get out quick. What do you know about the Memovira? She nods her head at the imposing gates across the courtyard. They say she runs this place from that fortress over there. I've never seen her, though. Just her thugs. It's almost like she doesn't dare come out. Anything else? No. And even I knew something, it's not safe to say. Until we meet again. Until we meet again. All right, we can interact with that. Let me look at this. A fleshy spout hangs from the wall, spewing yellowish water into the pool below. Now we're gonna drink this crap?
Yes.
That's our answer, yes. The pool is filled with yellowish water that falls from above. The surrounding bloom flesh is wet with hand and footprints, suggesting that this is a common place for bloom dwellers to wash and drink. Let's look into the pool. Perception check. The pool extends downward like the circular shaft of a well. If it has a bottom, you can't see it from here. In the depths of the pool, your sharp eyes catch sight of a long, worm-like shape. It appears to be caught on a projection of bloom flesh, and it's wriggling helplessly about. Hmm. Seam. Collect some of the fluid. You find a small discarded flask at the edge of the well and fill it with yellowish fluid. I got a flask of bloom water. Confers bloom juiced. Eerie whispers fill your mind, hinting at countless secrets to uncover. Active until next sleep. Consume movement. This flask contains a yellowish fluid you collected from a well in the bloom. It has a greasy texture and a faintly sour odor. When you take a sniff, you can hear the whispering voices of the bloom in your mind. I don't know when we're going to get to sleep yet. Next. Let's not drink it yet. Let's... let's dive into the pool and try to retrieve the wriggling object. Success! Stat pool spent on effort restored. You plunge into the murky fluid. As you dive deeper, you see that the shaft opens into a much larger cavity. We're gonna end up drinking this stuff. At the edge of the larger space, you reach the wriggling shape you saw from above and struggle to untangle it from a bony knot of bloom flesh. Finally, it slips free and you swim for the surface, reaching the top just before you run out of air. We got a warding worm? In the light of the courtyard, you see that the wriggling object is some sort of bloated worm, its skin continuously shifting from one material to another. Silvery metal, to pliable synth, to leathery scales, to other materials you can't identify. It seems to be drawn to your exposed flesh and would likely fasten itself to your arm or leg if you were allowed it to do so. You don't see anything else of interest in its depths. Confers protected, +6 armor and +2 resistance. Nice. The skin of this bloated worm is continually shifting from one material to another. Silvery metal to pliable synth to leathery scales to other materials that you can't identify. Yes, I read all this. It seems to be drawn to your exposed flesh and will fasten itself to your arm or leg if you allow it to do so. This would cause your skin to take on the same shifting properties as the worm, which will provide you with some additional protection. However, symbiotes like this creature rarely live for long, so the effect will be short-lived. Oh, don't use it. I don't know what bloom juiced is, and I don't want this to be something that's a pain in the ass because we just slept and I don't know where we can sleep again.
All right.
This is out. This is a Memovera thug. This goes to the vast interior. And that's Memovera's fortress. I mean, I know where I can sleep, but we can't afford it right now. Watch your step. I don't mean that as a threat. The bloom's acting strange, and no one knows why. Just keep your head down. If the Memavira's guards are worried, that means trouble's coming for the rest of us. Nobody's seen the Memavira in weeks. Bet she's lying in that tower of hers, cold and dead. Hmm. Several crude shanties are wedged into a corner, fashioned from scraps of wood, cloth, and metal. Whoever built them was apparently not concerned with safety. Don't touch me. Just leave me be. Leave me alone. Okay. You! This is me! My place! Scrounge your own hole. The metal gates are firmly shut. They are blemished with age, but still strong.